way to explain how I feel. I feel my heart is actually still beating so quickly.
I can't believe it, man. It's incredible. It's amazing. It's a dream.
We thought we had it, and then on the 2-2, I thought we were losing. I gave up, but you know, we have Messi, the best player in the world.
Going behind the scenes of the biggest prize in football, this is World Football in Qatar on the BBC World Service.
The circle is complete. 36 years after Maradona inspired Argentinian world champions, Messi finally has done the same. It turns out that sometimes real life really can be written in Hollywood. Hello, I'm Manny Jasmi, and welcome to our final World Cup podcast at a tournament that delivered more goals than any other before it. After one of the greatest finals in any competition ever, the destiny of Lionel Messi has been fulfilled. And the lucky man to mingle with the delirious Argentinian fans afterwards was Sam Sheringham.
Manny, I can't quite believe what I've just witnessed. A truly incredible World Cup final and a footballing fairy tale for the ages. This is the moment Argentina and Lionel Messi have dreamt about for years, and they've realised that dream in scenes of barely believable drama. There's hardly a dry eye to be seen among the 40,000 Argentina fans who have made the pilgrimage to see Messi emulate Maradona. They are singing, they are dancing, they are hugging, kissing and rejoicing all around me. Let's go and get in amongst them.
There is no way to explain how I feel. I feel my heart is actually still beating so quickly.
I can't believe it, man. It's incredible. It's amazing. It's a dream. It's a dream, man. It's incredible.
Thank you, man. You're hugging all your friends, quite rightly. Lionel Messi has done it. Argentina have done it.
No, Messi deserves, man. Messi deserves. He deserves for all it. Argentina is passing a bad time, but today we are celebrating, man. We are celebrating.
I don't have feelings left. I think tomorrow I'll wake up and my feelings will come back, but it was grueling. I thought after the game with Holland, nothing could be worse. But like to go up and to go down and to go up. But in the end, when we won, yeah.
I couldn't stop crying since the moment I hear my national song. I couldn't stop crying. It's super emotional for me. I came 1 year ago to Qatar. I work as a waitress all this time in Qatar, just to stay in Qatar and just to see these matches. So I'm super glad I did it. I knew this would happen. After I saw Copa America, after I watched that game, after we won, I said Messi will have the World Cup, and he did it.
How do you feel? Look at that smile on your face.
Where are you from?
I'm from England. Look at that smile on your face, sir. Imagine, tell me.
Imagine. We are absolutely happy. Absolutely grateful for the people of Qatar because of this wonderful cup. Absolutely. And we do always suffering, you know? We cannot win like just like that. Suffering till the last minute.
Alvarez, Fernandez, Dybala, Otamendi, they all deserve it, every single one of them. Di Maria, El Fideo, we call him the spaghetti. Every one of them deserves it. So it's just it was perfect.
Describe the way you and the rest of Argentina feel towards Lionel Messi now.
Oh my God, no. Like, you can't, there are no words to say that, you know? Like, we are super appreciative. And I think he showed everyone like what it is to be a good player and like an Argentinian with all the passion.
It was a crazy match. It wasn't like a relaxing match. We thought we had it, and then on the 2-2, I thought we were losing. I gave up, but you know, we have Messi, the best player in the world.
So Argentina are world champions, and there's no one better to talk to about it than one of our new friends that we've made in Doha this month, journalist and broadcaster Francisco Canepa. Has it been a good day, Francisco?
Manny, I have an incredible day, yes. I can't talk. My voice gives me away, betrays me. It's a dream come true, you know. I can't believe it. In fact, how the game was in the end, I was with my, I have 12 friends that came here all the World Cup, and I was able to watch the game with them, and it was an unnecessary suffering, totally, because Argentina was playing well, it was winning as well, and things were going right, and all of a sudden in 2 minutes or in 1 minute, Mbappé scores 2 goals and a nightmare appear. if you don't suffer, you can't enjoy. I think that this is a way better way of winning than if the result might been different.
Well, you say that now, Francisco, but I bet you would have much rather won 2-0.
Yeah, totally. My heart was at the edge of explosion. But yes, after what happened and after the result, I am saying this, but believe me that in the moment I was hoping that the match finishes 2-0, totally, or 3, and another goal of Messi, and it would be perfect.
Could you believe what you were seeing?
I can't believe it right now. I mean, in the clouds. It's a dream, and I'm not aware of what I'm living. I'm not aware of what is happening. In the end, I cried with my friends. It was a moment of 100% ecstasy, and now I can't believe it. I'm like floating in the air, and I think that in the next days I will be able to, or maybe weeks, months, I don't know. I will be able to know what I was capable of watching and enjoying and be part of, because we in the grandstand we felt part as well of what was happening and of the way Argentina fought and found some resilience, you know.
Who was the hero?
If you have to tell the whole story, I think Dibu Martinez was a total hero, because not only in the penalty kicks, the last game of the match was fantastic, with that opportunity of Kolo Muani and that saving of Dibu Martinez. Watching the whole picture in the tournament, Lionel Messi, but in this game, Dibu Martinez was superlative in that last minutes of the game.
And Dibu Emiliano Martinez, he's had an amazing journey, hasn't he, in the last few years, from not really having any future in club football to winning the World Cup.
Oh, it's incredible where the players were in the last World Cup. And he was playing in Getafe there in Spain with not so many minutes. And he had a wonderful story. He went to the World Cup, to Russia with his brother. And when we lost against France, he told his brother, or at least this is what he was talking about this whole year, he told his brother that he was going to be the goalkeeper in the next World Cup and he was going to make Messi champion. So it's a fairy tale for him. And I'm really glad, because it's like the example of hard work and never giving up.
But the big journey, the big story, is Lionel Messi's.
Totally.
And
yes,
when you think back to those 3 finals in a row that Argentina lost, Messi missed a penalty in the shootout, he retired from international football in 2016. Those were all part of his story. I mean, those were all meant to happen so that today would happen.
Totally, yes. I think that makes this thing, this trophy, more special. After what he had to suffer, I think his career in the national team is totally opposite to what happened in the clubs. That he began his career there, winning everything, and then he had to face the defeat. And in the national team, it was all around. He had to face defeat in the finals, no? But then he was able to taste the flavor of triumph. And I hope he don't retire, but he doesn't retire, but it's like the best way of all, retiring from a national team, being a World Cup champion, the best player in the tournament. The whole chapter, I think that it ends here. It has no more chapters for this novel.
This is Lionel Messi's 5th World Cup. Why has this team been successful instead of the teams of the other 4?
Because the ball went in, practically. Because the ball went in. Because in the other tournaments, Argentina had their chances. And I think that winning the American Cup in 2021 was also a key moment, because the other day when we were talking with you and Pat Gavin, he said something really smart and really true, that before somebody wins something, he thinks that he can win, and after winning, he knows that they can win. So I think Argentina knew when they arrived here to Qatar that they were able to win.
You mentioned Martinez as the hero. Some people will say Messi was the hero. Some will say Angel Di Maria was the hero for what he did. What about Gonzalo Montiel, who scored the winning penalty? Tell us about him.
I think he will never sleep, for sure, because he's a player as well that he got involved in the youth national teams. He played a World Cup in Korea where England won, and his career started. He was a center back. Then he played into the right. At the beginning, he had no temper. He had no personality in the pitch, and Marcelo Gallardo built a new player from him. And this is the example and the fruit of what he had done. Maybe this year in Sevilla he wasn't playing a lot. When Sampaoli came back to the team, he got several minutes. And I was imagining when he was walking to shoot the penalty, the responsibility that you have to have. He shot also against Netherlands, but this is a final. This was the last penalty. He knew that he scored, he was going to be, and the team was going to be, and Messi was going to be the world champions. And it's, I don't know how to put it in words. I think that for him is a unique moment.
Gonzalo Montiel was an unlikely hero, but so has Lionel Scaloni been an unlikely hero. And this is, I'm going to ask this question to you for the third time. It's the same question. Isn't it amazing what he has done?
Yes, totally. Yes, yes, yes. It's incredible. First of all, it's incredible. I told you the other day, he was the first coach in the history of the national team of Argentina to reach three semifinals in a row. He lost the first one, he won the last two, and he won the titles as well. He managed to learn a lot. I think he is really well surrounded by Ayala, by Samuel, and by Aymar. This was also a thing I told you the last day that we talked. And the way he tried to smooth things and to put like the feet on earth permanently, and not be focused on what can happen, but on what things that the team has to do to make that thing happen. He's a strategist, and I have to recognize that, because at the beginning I was a little bit skeptic of thinking about Scaloni like a successful coach, you know. I thought it was a transition. He was like the face of transition after a World Cup, that it was, everything was wrong, and all of a sudden he learned to drive the car and a Ferrari, and it's not for everyone, and he did it perfectly. He was Michael Schumacher.
On Thursday's podcast, we were speaking about the economic problems and the political challenges, difficulties in Argentina. What will this win mean to the people?
I think joy. Joy, and maybe think about something else but suffering, and knowing that the dreams sometimes they come true, and for Argentinian people to have a horizon, a future, I think it's necessary, because it's a suffered people. They suffer a lot, and they need to celebrate, to be happy, to have some joy, and to share, and to be a family again. There's a lot of resentment in Argentina, and I think that this was the seed of unity, or I hope this is the seed of unity from now on.
Francisco, we'll come back to you later in the podcast, because we're now going to address the jarring collision between football and human rights that has characterised this highly controversial tournament. FIFA and the organisers have always urged everyone to just focus on enjoying the football, but critics of Qatar's anti-LGBTQ+ laws and treatment of migrant workers have been worried that the glamour of Messi, Mbappe and the rest caused the focus to drift away from those issues. The big question now, though, is whether there'll be a positive World Cup legacy for those who remain in Qatar now that the football has ended. I've been speaking to Ambet Yuson. He's General Secretary of Building and Woodworkers International, a global trade union that's been in partnership with FIFA and the World Cup organisers for the last 6 years, and as a result has seen improvements in migrant worker conditions. But his post-tournament prognosis is bleak.
The World Cup is ending, and there is a deafening silence on the future of migrant workers in Qatar. There is no genuine commitment from FIFA or from the Qatar authorities to remedy the abuses. For us, there is no legacy if migrant workers, the families of construction workers who died, are not compensated. There is no legacy if workers were not paid by their employers their due wages. And there is no legacy if they have not compensated the recruitment fees.
What have conditions been like for workers during the World Cup?
Two workers died. One of the community leaders are helping the migrants because they were not paid wages. Just imagine, the World Cup is being played and migrant workers were not being paid for 3 months, for 5 months. This leader assisted the workers and filed a complaint, and it's legitimate to complain. But instead of resolving the complaint, the security forces arrested him. They said it's a misunderstanding, you know, but it's too much to have a person stayed overnight in jail. But the person is free now, because we complained about it. But just imagine, without the World Cup, this kind of arrest will continue to happen and no one will know. And there will be abuses, there will be violation. We are worried about more than 200,000 construction workers who were sent home because of the World Cup. These workers showed us a memorandum from the government authorities and from their companies that in the 4 months around the World Cup, they have to cut down construction work. They don't want to see construction work. You know, it has to be beautiful. They were asked to take their vacation, but there is no assurance that they will be paid. So it's a forced vacation. And they don't know if they will be asked to come back. And, you know, with a weak enforcement mechanism in Qatar, many recruitment agencies will take advantage of this, no? Close the contract and collect another recruitment fees.
BWI has been working with FIFA and the World Cup Organising Committee since 2016, so it's not like you're criticising from the sidelines. But in a way, that makes what you're saying even stronger. What's happened to that cooperation? Is there still a dialogue?
We have worked with them and we have seen that change is possible. For example, the introduction of non-discriminatory minimum wage. There is the abolition of the discriminatory nature of the kefala system. Policies on health and safety and heat stress. However, before the World Cup, we asked them, now we have to make sure that this change would continue even after the World Cup. We told FIFA and the Qatar authority, any promise of any improvement for the future, or even President Infantino's announcement of a World Cup legacy for the migrants, for us, they are all empty words without independent workers' organization and trade unions. That's why we told them we have two demands. Number one is to establish and recognize a migrant worker center. A migrant worker center is a safe haven for workers where they can receive legal assistance, be educated on their rights, and they can speak without fear or retaliation from the authorities. Then the second demand is to establish remedy fund to compensate the families of the workers who died, the workers whose wages were not paid, the workers who were, you know, have paid illegal recruitment fees. This demand is an important indicator that reforms will continue after the World Cup. They did not reply. The change that was done for the workers in the stadium, it's only for the workers in the stadium, not for the rest of the country. It's not sustainable. And probably it's only for public relations.
Are you encouraged by FIFA's announcement in the last couple of days that it's starting a human rights and social responsibility subcommittee to look at human rights going forward?
These are all empty promises, announcement without real basis, no? FIFA also said they are going to consult the international trade unions, but there's no consultation at all. They have to talk to the affected workers. These promises are empty promises. It has to be beyond media announcement.
You sound very gloomy about the potential for a positive World Cup legacy for workers in Qatar.
Yes, because there is no indication that the trade union, the international trade union, can legally operate there. We have shown to them that we are a partner. We have shown that we have improved the working condition. So it's possible. But without us, any reform will not be credible. If deaths are happening during the World Cup, if workers are arrested during the World Cup, if their wages are not paid during the World Cup, how can we be assured that there will be real sustainable change after the World Cup? The fans all go home, but the workers will remain. And this is our appeal to the football fans, the football players. Keep the fight of the migrants alive in Qatar, even after the World Cup. We need your help.
Strong words from Ambet Yuson, General Secretary of the Building and Woodworkers International Trade Union. We put his comments to FIFA, the Supreme Committee for Delivery and Legacy, and the Qatar government, but received no replies. This is the sound of Souq Waqif, the main bazaar in central Doha, which has been a meeting place for thousands of fans throughout the World Cup. It's comprised of narrow alleys lined by shops selling everything from spices to handcraft. There's even an alley dedicated to the sale of birds. Anyway, our Sam Sheringham decided to do one last spin round the old place to get some fans' reflections on what it's been like to be in Qatar for the last month. And it was there where he bumped into one of world football's breakout stars of Doha 22.
So just walking through the souk, and I've bumped into Leandro Blanco, one of the four cyclists who cycled all the way from Cape Town to be here to see Argentina in the World Cup. Leandro, great to have you back on the podcast. Just tell me, you arrived in Qatar a couple of weeks before the tournament started. What's your experience been like here, of the people and the place, the country?
Hello, Sam. So nice to meet you again. Yeah, we arrived here by bike November 7th. And it was an amazing experience to stay here. So for this World Cup, because it's in the middle of the desert with a different culture, other people, it's so hospitality. He loved to share the culture and all the tradition, like Arabic coffee, the chai, the food. A lot of people invite us to know the houses and all the lifestyle, so we are so happy because it's not just football for us here. We met a lot of lovely person here in Qatar.
And I can see you've all got your bikes right here next to us in the souk. All ready to ride home on?
Yeah. We ride a lot here in Qatar, but it's enough for us. After final, we will put the bikes in a big box and put it in the airplane and go home.
Mohammed, yes. Tell me, I'm just catching up with fans on the general World Cup experience of Qatar. How have you found it, supporting Morocco here in this country?
We're so proud to be here because it's an Arabic country hosting the Cup. What they have done for the last couple of years preparing for this World Cup is amazing. I'm sure there was a lot of effort, there was a lot of planning, and definitely a lot of money. They were able to prepare all of this and to be able to bring all the world together. Of course, he didn't forget about showing everyone our cultures, our Arabic culture, and then we can see it everywhere we go. I think it's very nice, and I think that everybody really likes it here. It's amazing.
What's your experience been of Qatar as a World Cup host?
Well, I think it's been a lot of criticism about Qatar before the World Cup, and you know, I don't know if they call it the World Cup of the shame or something like that. But I think since I've been here, I've really enjoyed it. I think the people have been extremely welcoming and friendly and helping, and the place is safe, well organized. I can only say good things about it. And yes, we miss a few beers, but that's about it. For the rest, we are really having a good time, and you know, all the fans are having a great time. So it's been wonderful.
How have you found to do on the days when there aren't any matches? How have you filled your time?
Well, there seems to be always something going on. You know, there's a show, there's a music. You go to the fan fest. You you know, go to different areas. You go to the souk, the market. You meet some other fans. Now, there's some nice areas. You know, went to the Pearl, that really modern area. That's quite amazing. I mean, Qatar is very interesting, and you know, it's so far away from you know, traditional Europe, and but it's kind of fun.
I've bumped into a wonderfully dressed Cameroonian man named Zomo, who considers himself. What would you say you are? Say you're here. You're playing. You've been playing some music. What's your role in this World
mascot,
Cup?
I'm a mascot. Mascot is people who make the event, man. They make football become the best in the world. That's what I think.
Yeah, you give some atmosphere to this place. And how have you found Qatar? Someone who comes from Cameroon, how have you found Qatar as a place to host the World Cup?
Qatar is very beautiful place. For me, it's one of the best places you can live because it's very hot. You feel good. You don't have a cold like in England or in France. It's like a new summer. You finish summer in Europe and come here and get summer again. That's why it's so good. I love it. I enjoy it. I do myself to be the best I can. And Qatar is very beautiful. One of the beautiful countries. The metro is wonderful.
You're still here to create atmosphere, to be a mascot, make people feel good at the stadiums. Come on then, Zoma, give me a little blast of your...
I make my song for the World Cup, for all the World Cup in the world. Anytime you see the World Cup, you see me, you see this song.
Yeah, man! Say something high to the people, you know what I'm saying? Welcome to the World Cup, welcome! Welcome, everybody!
What an utterly joyful man. I imagine it's almost impossible not to do a skip after meeting Zomo, an indomitable lion of Cameroon speaking to our indefatigable lion, Sam Sheringham. Well, they say that history is written by the winners, so let's give the last word to our friend Francisco Canepa. How will you remember Qatar 2022?
Like a movie. I work as a journalist, but I lived the games of Argentina as a fan because I had my friends here, and I am thinking of tattooing something, you know, if I'm honest. So it's a movie, a perfect movie. The best book that I could ever read and be part of. This is a movie, a Hollywood movie, or Argentinian movie, because we like to suffer as well.
Yeah, I suppose you can't really enjoy ice cream without having vegetables first, can you?
No, totally. You have to suffer to enjoy. That's the word. You have to have your vegetables to enjoy dessert.
Are you a tattoos guy? Do you have tattoos already?
I have two tattoos. I have one Homer Simpson, and I have I love The Simpsons. And I have some coordinates from Spain for when I met my wife, so it was a beautiful tattoo as well. But now I have a space for the World Cup, and I don't know if some letter as well. I will see. I have to talk with my friends and decide the tattoo.
Francisco, fantastic to get to know you during this World Cup. I hope we can keep in touch. And you don't need a plane ticket because you can float home to Argentina, can't you?
Yeah, totally. I think I'm going to throw it away and I'm going to fly by myself. But thank you very much, Manny. It's a pleasure. I really enjoy talking with you and your guys. We keep in touch.
Thanks to Francisco and all of our contributors during the last month. By our count, we've heard voices representing 24 of the 32 World Cup teams, whether they were players, fans or journalists. I really hope you've enjoyed our podcasts. We've tried to take you to Qatar and put you at the heart of the greatest show on earth. Thank you very much indeed for listening. And a huge thanks to the team. Sam Sheringham, whom you've heard in various episodes, not least today, but he's done so much more than that. I don't think he's slept for a month. Thanks also to the shadowy puppeteer, Richard Padula, back at base, John Bennett for his programmes, reports and recordings, and thanks to Peter Victor, who got us off and running at the start, what seems like an age ago. I'll be back on Thursday when I'll try and fit in as much of Roy Hodgson's 46-year coaching career as time allows when I sit down with the former England, Switzerland and Inter Milan coach. In the meantime, football belongs once again to Argentina.